What are we doing today? Well, today we're building a paper tiger. Now you might wonder, what the heck is a paper tiger? A paper tiger is an engine that is usually built on a cocktail napkin with a pen or a pencil. But today we used a computer and some high-tech doodly-doo to make it happen. So after the break, we're gonna take and look at a big block, 390 and a 445 from the guys at Survival Motorsports. Hey guys, thanks for muscling in here today to watch the FE stuff. And what I want you to do for me right now is leave a comment in the section below. Let us know what you think about the video. Give us a thumbs up, give us a thumbs down. It is entirely up to you. We appreciate you guys coming in here each week and watching the show and seeing what we're up to. Also, if you like us enough, subscribe, hit that bell for notification. That way you'll know every time we put a video up, and there's gonna be a lot more things coming. We're actually bringing someone in to help me edit so we can do even more Manic Mechanic stuff over on the other side. But today, we are focusing on the FE engine. All right, so what are we building today? We're actually not building anything. These kind of engines I call paper tigers because it's just a piece of paper. You can use a freaking cocktail napkin if you want to and a ballpoint pen to put them together. This one I did on my computer talking to Barry Robotnik at Survival Motorsports, who is, in my opinion, the man for FE engine builds. So what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna talk about what the basic street engine is going to be from the guys at Survival Motorsports. Now they can give you a turnkey engine if you want, or you can bring this stuff and build it yourself, getting some parts from them if you need to, but also you can just use what you've got and the information provided on the street engine and get a really decent powered engine, which we'll go over the power numbers at the very end because I want you to kind of stick around for the whole video. So, when you're building your 390 big block, what are you gonna do? You're gonna use your standard bore block. Whatever block you have will work just fine. For your rotating mass in there, you're gonna want your crank to be a standard crank. You're probably gonna have to turn it down a little bit. If you're unlucky enough to do that, it's probably gonna go 10-10. That'll be okay, won't cause a problem. Connecting rods on that are going to just be your standard connecting rods that are in your big block 390. With the exception, you will be using ARP rod bolts on it to make sure you've got a good, you know, thing to keep those coffee can sized pistons going in the directions that they need to go in. For pistons, you're going to be using sealed power, hypereutectic pistons taking 30 over, and then you'll be using a Speed Pro chrome moly ring on that piston. Now, for the rotating assembly, Barry doesn't say anything about balancing, but as far as the rest of it is concerned, you'll want to deck the block, make sure everything's nice and square. Brand new freeze plugs, cam bearings, all that stuff will be replaced. If Barry's doing it, I'll give you a total parts cost out on at the end. Anything that we talk about in here is in the description below as far as parts and how much it costs for Barry to put that sucker together for you. Now we're going to get to the thing that everybody wants to know about and one of the things that everybody always talks about, and that's the camshaft. And you're probably thinking, I bet they've got some crazy wild grind that they're using in there. Now, the cam is the Leisure Suit Larry of cams because it is the high energy 260H cam from Comp Cams. It's a 260-260 on intake and exhaust duration. That's advertised duration, not at 50 thousandths. I couldn't find the information on the 50 thousandths duration on that cam. Your lift is a straight pattern cam as lift as well. It is 484 and 484. I do not have any lobe separation information for you. Operating range on this cam is 1200 RPMs to 5200 RPMs. Now, as far as the valve train is concerned, all your sled fulcrums and all that stuff, the standard is just fine on a big block 390. Just reuse the original style stuff. If you want to get them replaced, it's probably a good idea at this point on some of these engines, and then go in with a standard comp push rod and standard comp lifters on it, and you'll be just fine with that part of the engine. Now for your timing chain set, I'm just gonna say a standard double roller timing chain. Anything's pretty good. Comp probably sells a decent one. I like Cloy's because I've been using them for years. But whatever you want to use for a double roller, that's probably going to be your best bet. Oiling, very important. You're going to want to run a Melling oil pump, get it checked out, pull it apart, take a look at it, make sure everything's good inside, and then use an ARP drive shaft on it. Believe me, that is probably the most important thing to your engine because that is the absolute lifeblood of your 390 right there. Now, for dampers, you're probably thinking another wild thing. No, but what's really cool is the Scott Drake has a new damper for the big block 390s available over the counter. If your damper's in decent shape, still get it redone when you're rebuilding the engine, because you never know, they can shift around. Now, I know that the 390 is internally balanced, but it is a good idea to make sure your damper's in good shape. The last thing you want to do is have that ring fly off of there. Take out the pulleys, take out the front of the engine, possibly take out the radiator. Seriously, I've seen it happen before. So make sure your damper's in good shape. If you can buy one from Scott Drake, why wouldn't you just go ahead and do something like that? So there you go. Now the next thing we're gonna talk about is cylinder heads, and you're probably thinking, again, he's gonna say something about Super Cobra Jet heads. No, I'm gonna say this. The guys at Survival Motorsports have built big block 390s with truck heads that pull some exceptional numbers that blow my mind for a truck head. So I can say right now with pure confidence that whatever head you have, as long as it's not a strangulation head, it's gonna be fine. If you want more detailed information, go out and start doing some research on heads to use on big block 390s. But I'm gonna tell you right now, you can probably get really decent power out of a set of truck heads. It's just the way these things go. So heads, not a big secret. Your heads will probably work. Now you're probably thinking we're gonna go with an aftermarket intake manifold on this thing because that intake manifold is as heavy as Motorhead. And if you're not into heavy metal, that just made absolutely no sense to you, but that intake manifold weighs 98 pounds, one of the weights I've seen for it. But oddly enough, the stock FE cast iron intake is really good. It actually flows very, very well. Somebody back in the day did their numbers just right and they flowed that bad boy out and made it run like it's supposed to. So I would say that a stock cast iron FE intake manifold will be just fine. If you're trying to save weight, then you can go after something in the Edelbrock line or whatever to get yourself a little less weight in the engine bay of your car. Now, speaking of Edelbrock, I wanted to give you a little side story here from Barry Robotnik about the Edelbrock Performer packages. And I asked him about saying, well, should you just do a package setup? And he said that the 390 FE package is actually really good. He said that when they dyno tested one on an engine that a customer brought to him with the complete Edelbrock package on it, they actually got really good numbers. As a matter of fact, they got the numbers that Edelbrock said that they would get for horsepower out of the engine at 414. Note to you guys that are waiting on the numbers, that's not the numbers we're talking about here. But the Edelbrock packages actually work really, really well. So that's a side note for you too, but you're not going to be a budget build anymore if you use the Edelbrock stuff. Well, now we're gonna talk about carburetors. Carburetors pretty simple for Barry and I both. Holley's the way to go. 750 CFM vacuum secondary. I don't know if I would go with the 750. Barry likes the 750. I might go 700, but he's the guy with all the experience and he's the guy that made all the horsepower. So you should probably just go with the 750. Now what you're wondering about is what the distributor needs to be. Oddly enough, I'm not going to say Petronix right away. What I will say is this, is you can go out and do a distributor from the later Ford truck line in the 360s. The 360 FE had a DuraSpark system in it that works really, really well. My only caveat in that is I don't like the DuraSpark from one aspect only, and that's because you have that box and a lot of wiring that has to go somewhere near the distributor in the engine bay. It's just one more thing to clutter up the inner fenders on your classic car. That's one of the main reasons I like the Petronix, because it doesn't clutter up the engine bay. There, I said it. So what is your total parts, tax, title, and drive out from Barry Robotnik? If he puts everything together for you parts-wise, it's $4,189.30 as of, you know, January 2021. I don't know why he's so precise, but he is. You would think he would fudge it up a little bit, but he doesn't. All right, this next part I'm going to read because, quite frankly, there's just a lot of information here, but I'm gonna go through this and line list everything out for you. So, what the engine machining with Barry is a bore and hone with torque plates, deck the head surfaces, line hone the mains, install cam bearings, mill the intake manifold to fit, and what that means is the intake manifold will fit to the cylinder heads and you won't have that stupid step that the FE develops. I don't know what the engineer was thinking when he did that, but he wasn't thinking very clearly because that's a stupid idea. Yeah, I said that. And that's also regrinding and polishing your crankshaft, assembling the engine, and dyno testing and break-in. Now a total out for all of that being done with Barry is $7,749.30. hanging on to that 30 cent, isn't it? So what is involved with the 445? Well, you're going to be going in a little bit different direction financially when you're doing something like this, because you're going to be trying to get more horsepower out of the engine. So one of the first things I noticed is that he's using a stock 390 block. All right, with that, he's using a scat cast crank. It's really hard for me to say that. I've done it like four times. Now this is five. And with that, he's doing a stroked crank from them, which that's what they're really famous for, is stroked cranks, and it is a 4.250 stroke on that. He's also using scat H-beam rods, and those are 6.700 rods in length, so that you get that 445 cubic inches. He's also using Molnar technology stuff occasionally too. He really likes them just as well as scat, so you may see some of that in his kind of stuff. Molnar is somebody to go check out because they're new and up and coming, and they have really good products for FEs, so you might want to look at them and check them out as well. Now for pistons, he's using a moly piston, and it's a 10.5:1 forged unit. For rings, he's using total seal rings. Now he didn't say what type of rings, but I'm only going to assume that they're a chrome moly ring, and you'll notice a name change here. We're going into a higher level of component as far as cost and as far as quality. Not that the other stuff is bad, but we're talking about going from a street engine to a race engine, and that's why some of these names are going to be a little different. Now he's going to be using Federal Mogul bearings on this, and this is the race bearing sets, not the standard street bearing sets. Again, with that stuff ad nauseum, I'm not going to say it again. Everything from here on out is just race stuff. Okay? So his oil pump is going to be a Melling oil pump. He's going to use, again, an ARP shaft on that. Lifeblood of the engine, blah, blah, blah. He's using a Moroso T-type pan with a Canton windage tray underneath it to keep that oil from slinging around and knocking into those coffee can-sized pistons as they go up and down inside that bore. He's using a Daco Power Bond damper with a billet spacer on it. Power, performance, blah, blah, blah. Now we're going to talk about the cam on this, and I'm going to pull my piece of paper up yet again because I'm not going to be able to remember all the specs on it. This is a Comp Cams hydraulic roller cam, and the specs on it are a 234, 240 at 50 thousandths, and that's intake and exhaust, and a 594 lift, and a 110 or 112 lobe separation depending on which one he needs. He also gets cams from a company called Bullet Cams, and they have one that is a 224, 230 at 50 thousandths, and a 570 lift with a 110 degree lobe separation. And that's really dependent on what he's working on. Sometimes when you're building engines, right now especially with COVID going on, you may have problems getting parts for an engine, so you have to have a couple of different suppliers that give you the same kind of juice for what you need for the car. Now for lifters, he's using Morel roller lifters, and I find a lot of times that the guys who are building these high performance engines are using a different lifter from the manufacturer of the cam. So keep that in your mind, the Morel lifter with a Comp Cams hydraulic roller cam. He's also using aftermarket push rods. He didn't say this, but I'm just going to say Manly. I've used Manly push rods for years. That's a personal thing. He didn't spec it in his engine stuff. That's just for me. Now he's using a double roller timing chain set on this, just like we talked about before. I would probably go with a Cloyes because that's just what I would use and what I have used for years. For cylinder heads, he is using an aftermarket head. He's using his. He makes his own cylinder heads, has them for the FE, and he has done a lot of trail work on this to try to figure out what's going to be the best combination. So he has those available. He uses a Harlan Sharp roller sled assembly for it. Really a nice piece. Harlan makes some of the best stuff out there as far as rocker arms and things of that nature. As far as intake manifolds, he uses an Edelbrock Performer RPM intake, tops that with a Holley 750 double pumper, because you just want as much gas to throw down the throat of that pig as you possibly can. So he's running for ignition systems, the billet MSD setup. Some guys don't like MSD. That's just a personal thing. Whether you want to run them or not, that's up to you. He's also running MSD wires on it as well. And that's pretty much it. You know, there's a bunch of other little stuff that's down in the description below that I could talk about, but it's really not germane to the situation here. That's the thing, like, what has the Germans got to do with it? Total parts on this engine are $10,667.09. And yes, Barry's still after that last little bit there. So all of your standard machining stuff is going to be done to this engine, but it's also going to be balanced, unlike the street engine. The street engine didn't get a balancing job on it. Balancing is about $1,900 from Barry. And then if you wanted to, you could go in and have the engine dyno tuned for $1,000, and assembly is going to cost you $1,500. Obviously, those would be backwards because you'd get it assembled and then dynoed. But your total tax, title, and drive out is $14,442.09. He cracks me up with that. I don't even know why. All right, so numbers. Here's where the rubber meets the road, literally, because when you put this thing on a car, it's going to flat fly. You're looking at a rough number on the street engine of about 375 horsepower, and with the high performance engine, about 500 horsepower. And you say, well, sure, I can get that out of a Coyote engine. And by gosh, if you couldn't get that out of a Coyote engine, that would tell me that engineering prowess has just gone in the toilet, because the guys in Dearborn can't figure out how to get their stuff together, you know, in the preceding 50 bloody years. I mean, the Coyote should just absolutely scream and get really great gas mileage. It's just the way it's supposed to be. So there you go, folks. That's what we have for you this week on the Paper Tigers. There will be more Paper Tigers coming, as I said before. Be sure to check out our Patreon account. Patreon at the $10 a month level, you get monthly meetings with me on Zoom. We have a lot of fun. We talk tech stuff. You can ask all kind of tech questions. It's a great place to get to know some of the other people who watch the show. And they're really cool folks. It's not like they're a bunch of weirdos. So with all that, folks, be sure to love on each other, like each other, treat each other nice. You guys have a great week, and we'll see you next time on Autorestomod for more Paper Tigers. This has to have been the hardest video I've shot in months, because look at this. 4 pages of information, and this isn't even the 4 pages of information that I have to put on the description. There's just lots of work. It's good though. I enjoyed it. Hope you enjoyed it. If you didn't, give me a thumbs down. It's the way it goes sometimes. People just do it. I don't know. They get mad at you.